Hi. So just like I did for combinational circuits, I wanted to just kind of show you some circuits in Logisim and just play around with them just a little bit so you can get an idea for how they work. Again, I highly recommend that you go and play around with this yourself. I think it's a lot more intuitive if you are doing it yourself. But I figured I would just give you a little bit of a preview of it, or you know, if you are unable to get the software working on your own computer, at least you have this video. So this is the SR and OR latch that we talked about first, and you can see that the behavior is the way we expected it. So turning S sets Q to 1, setting R resets it to 0, and basically this just remembers the last thing that was pressed. So if R was the last thing that was pressed, then Q is going to be 0. If S is the last thing that was pressed, then Q is going to be 1. And you can see here in this one that nothing truly horrible happens if both of them are on, right? It just so happens that the R kind of overrides the Q. So that's the AND OR latch. The NOR latch is this one right here. So again, the red indicates, right, that we don't have a value for that. We don't know what it is yet. So we can press S to turn on Q, which turns off Q prime. So Q prime is always supposed to be the opposite of Q. And so, you know, I can turn S on and off. That's not going to change anything once Q is set. But once I turn on R, that resets it. And Q is now storing 0. Q prime is storing 1. So we said also remember that we were going to disallow the situation when both of these are on. And that's because we have this undesirable situation where now Q and not Q are both 0, which is a problem. We cannot induce the kind of oscillating behavior that we mentioned in Logisim because we can't turn both of these off simultaneously, which is what would be required in order to do that. So once we turn off one of these, then it's it goes back to, you know, whatever the other one was. So anyway, that's the SR latches, and then here's the D latch that hopefully you'll play with a little bit more in the lab. So again, this is from the book. This is kind of like a D is kind of the data bit, and then S is sort of the set or save the data. And so as long as S is set, then the output is going to change when I change D. And then once I turn off the set bit, then the circuit's going to remember the last data value that was there when I had set on. So this is basically remembering the last value of D the last time that S was on. All right, and then finally, as you might imagine, we can now take this, and once we have D flip-flops, and I'm actually using the built-in component for this here because it works a little bit better. So this is these are four D, or sorry, not four. These are eight D flip-flops all arranged here. We have some data coming in, so this is like a data write coming in, and then we have the data read coming out. And so these are buses that are 8 bits wide, and then we have our clock signal. And so you can imagine the clock signal kind of all oscillating back and forth here. So the way to think about this is that there's some computation going on in the CPU, and at some point, you know, some value comes through, and this is going to be the new value of this register. So this is the value coming in. You'll notice it hasn't changed yet, right? So this is the new value coming in, and so we have enough time. We set our clock cycle long enough so that everything can propagate. We know that this is going to be the final answer. This is the register value that we want to use for the next cycle. And so at the point at which the clock tick rises, that locks in our value, and now we can use that value for the next cycle. And you'll notice that even if we go ahead and start changing this as the computation starts to propagate, that's not changing the value that's coming out of the register. That's the key here, is that we can still rely on this stable previous value of the register even while we're calculating the new value of the register. And so all the time that this clock cycle is going, this can be changing, and then it gets locked in again, the new value, at the end of the new clock cycle, or at the end of the old clock cycle and the beginning of the new one. So that's, again, just a little bit of a demo. I included a couple of other interesting ones in here. Another one that I like a lot is this counter. So this is a circuit that actually counts in binary. And so if you sit here and keep clicking the count every time you click, or the clock, every time you turn the clock on or off, it adds one to the output. And so it would be worth thinking about that and how that works. But I think it's pretty cool. And there are a couple other circuits in there for you to play around with as well. But I hope that this has helped a little bit, at least to maybe visualize what's going on and to gain maybe a slightly deeper intuitive understanding about how these sequential circuits work. The analysis is a little bit more difficult than it is with combinational. So it's useful to have pictures in your head when you're thinking about these things.